The gear template generator program is a program designed to allow you to interactively design sets of gears, which you can then print paper templates of to cut out on the bandsaw. Here's one set of gears that I cut from a paper template. Because they're actually proper involute spur gears, they actually turn quite smoothly even when turning quite fast. The gear template generator allows you to check whether certain types of gears would work very well or not in real life. For example, let's make the gear on the left a fair bit smaller and animate that. And it's a little bit iffy. It looks like there might be a bit of a problem. So let's zoom in on that a little bit. And let's stop the rotation and turn that manually. And that's a little bit iffy. Those gears might work, but they're not going to turn very smoothly. Let's show the line of contact. So this line here is the line along which the contact always happens. You'll notice that the contact surface is always perpendicular as we slowly rotate through here. And we can see we're at the end of the engagement of one tooth here. This undercut, I don't actually do undercut here, so it's getting a little bit iffy towards the end of that here, and we still haven't engaged the next tooth. So these gears will not turn perfectly well. In fact, even here we actually have the one gear jabbing into the other one, so if we zoom in on that a bit more, we can see that there's a little bit of interference here. We can do a little bit better on the interference by changing the angle of the teeth. That tends to work better for smaller gears, but we still have a bit of a problem, so we've disengaged here and we haven't engaged the next one. And involute gears with only four teeth really don't work very well. With five, they can just barely work. So here, we're still not engaging. But maybe if we bump up the angle a bit more. No, it's just not very good. So typically, to get a good gear, you need at least six teeth. Seven works better, which is why the ones I made out of plywood actually had seven teeth on them, because you kind of need a bit more just to engage. The trouble with large angles like that is that the gears are much less efficient. So really, we want to have this angle here, say something like 14 degrees, at which point these very small number of teeth gears really don't work very well. If we look on here, there we've got overlap here. So that's generally used for a much larger number of teeth gears. So let's zoom out on this a little bit. So these are still very small gears. In general machinery, the smallest you would do is maybe 14 teeth. Let's make the other one a little bit bigger. Let's make that one 30. So with that number of teeth, 14 degree gear will actually work fairly well. So zoom in on that a bit and animate it. And it looks like we're just okay. So real machinery that's made out of steel uses more teeth on the gears. If you cut gears out of plywood, it's quite a bother to cut all these out on the bandsaw, so you often want to go for a smaller number of teeth as possible. If you like your gears to look a little bit ornamental, you can also decorate them with some spokes. I'll zoom out on this a little bit. The spokes can only be displayed for gears that have a larger number of teeth. If the gears are too small, then there's just no room for spokes. So if we make this gear smaller, suddenly the spokes disappear. Although there's room for three spokes, but going a bit smaller, even then there's no room for the spokes. So spoking is more of a fun sort of feature. In addition to doing regular spur gears, the program can also do rack and pinions. So for example, let's change this to a rack and we can watch how this engages here. Or let's change it to a ring gear. And the ring gear is one gear inside the other. You'd use that sort of thing for example, planetary motion gears. Now, as you're doing all this, the program always calculates the shaft center to center distance. So right now it's 7.77. If I change the number of teeth on any gear, that always changes. If you watch that number here while I change it. If I wanted to make this an exact number because I'm targeting a specific shaft distance, I can just go in here and I can enter a number. So for example, to make it 10 centimeters. With a 5 centimeter grid, that is the size of two grid lines on here. Right now the program is operating in centimeters, but you can also change the units. So for example, if I change this to inches, now all the units are specified in inches. My gears are still showing the same size because the screen is also now changed in inches, but if I go to print that out, that'll be very much a different size. The program can also handle different types of gear teeth, so instead of involute, we can also specify pinwheel gearing. With a pinwheel, one gear is actually a series of pins, the other one is a cycloid. Now, right now, the pins are very small, let's make that bigger. And we still have the one gear inside the other. The inside gearing with the pinwheels can produce some very funky shapes, but let's go back to regular spur gear, and we can see how the teeth here nicely mesh. There's always engagement with one or the other, for example, with these. The calculations for that are quite complex internally, but as you can see, these gears will always fully engage. Of course, we can put one inside the other, or let's put the pins on the outside and put the other gear on the inside. So here we have, for example, a three-tooth gear inside of a large pinwheel, and let's animate that. So this one, we've got a bit of a jaggy here. That's not an ideal set of parameters, but let's change the pin diameter. And so, for instance, this will be something that will run very, very smoothly and will always be fully engaged, even though we only have three teeth on here. This is actually one of the advantages of pinwheel gearing, is that you can go very small. Now let's put this gear on the outside. So we'll make this gear a spur gear. Now we've got the the pin ring here and the three tooth gear on here. We can also make the small gear the pinwheel and the other one going the other way around. So let's change that one to three, and let's change that one to be a big one. So we have here just three pins on here, and let's get rid of that center hole. It's distracting. So if we change that to zero, then the center hole goes away altogether. And let's turn off displaying of the centers. And we can see here that these actually pretty much fully engage with only three teeth. Let's turn off the animation and let's flip through this. Oops. Let's rotate through this very, very slowly. And we can see we have both sides here engaged. And as we go through rotation, we start to get disengagement here, but we're just barely starting to engage this tooth on both this pin here on both sides. So a gear like this will actually work just barely, even though it has just three teeth. Whereas if this was just a involute gear, that would never really work. See, we've got overlap here, and no matter what gear angle we choose, that's just not going to work. We're always going to run into some problems there in the middle. So this is where the pinwheels is very, very useful. So out of curiosity, I ended up building one of these pinwheel gears. Instead of pins, I actually used little rotor ball bearings. They're 3/8 of an inch diameter, and it turns quite smoothly. In fact, I can even spin it up quite fast. There's a bit of rattling. It's not perfect, but it works surprisingly well. The pinwheels can get very funky when you have one inside the other of almost the same number of teeth. So let's put four pins here, and we'll change that one to three. And let's make that a little bit bigger. And now let's put this one inside the other one. So we make the pinwheel a ring, and it's kind of interesting. You can see how these will actually engage, and it's locked in place. So a very cool combination here. Let's make this one a little bit bigger, and it's still actually kind of locked in there. If we stop this here, this gear can't fall into the center of these at all because it's always engaged like this. So there's some very interesting things that you can do with pinwheels with one inside the other. If we go the opposite way, let's change the other one into a ring. We also again have a very interesting sort of combination here, and it's also locked in place. It's also very interesting if you have, for instance, just three inside of here, the pins will follow a straight path. This is actually quite logical. Let's change that, for instance, just to four and two. And this is your classical ellipse type drawing mechanism. Anytime you have a factor of two difference between the two for the inside gearing, you get this sort of interesting pattern. Now let's return to some more normal gear parameters. So let's change these to involute, and let's change the number of teeth here, and make that outside gear. And we'll change the units back to centimeters and make the teeth a bit smaller and make this one bigger. So now each of the grid lines here represents 5 centimeters. So this gear is actually a little bit bigger than what fits on the page. So let's do a print preview. And you can see it doesn't quite fit. So we have this thing extending to a second page. Now typically we'd use this to print it out and cut it out with a bandsaw or a scroll saw. So we don't really want to show both gears at a time, so we'd print that and then we'd print the small gear. Let's go back to the bigger gear and let's do a print preview on that again. Now it's hard to line up two pages when you're doing a printout like that. There is a few lines to help you line it up, but it really helps to have more things to guide your lining up things by. So let's make the grid lines a bit smaller and let's turn on the grid diagonals. With the grid diagonals, it's really much easier to line up the two halves of the printout, because you just make sure that the diagonals line up, and that's very easy to judge very accurately, so you can get these two pieces to exactly line up. Now, this actually shows it with a little bit of overlap, but the printer won't actually print to the margins, so when you print this out, there's actually no overlap at all. If you prefer to have overlap, you can actually specify additional overlap here. So, for instance, let's say 5 centimeters overlap. And let's do a print preview again. And we have much more overlap showing here, like this now. So, here's gluing in the last page of a multi-page printout, and I'm using the diagonal lines to help me line it up. I was actually a little bit sloppy about how I cut the paper out. So my line has a slight gap in it, although that's not really much of a problem because it's a small enough gap that I can just follow it by eye with my bandsaw. You can also export the gear shapes to various programs. You can export to DXF, which is accepted by most CAD programs. You can export to SketchUp, as well as HPGL and CSV. There's more details about exporting in the help, which you can get at through the links at the end of this video. Now, a totally funky and useless feature of the program is what I call wobbly mode. In wobbly mode, all the gears are shown a little bit distorted. It's as though you're looking at it through a swimming pool. It's basically what the eval version of the program does. But I decided to leave this feature in the regular version, except that you can turn it off, because I just find that very, very fun to watch. To see these wobbly gears turning around. And this sort of takes me to the bad news here. This program is actually not a free program. You have to buy it off my website. But if you just want to play around with it and see what the program can do for you, the free version, the eval version, can do absolutely everything that I was just showing you. But wobbly mode is always turned on, so you can't actually use it to print any gears that work. You can see the gears meshing on here, but it's space that's distorted. So if you were to print these gears, it just wouldn't work as an actual gear. But you can just do everything to explore the program, and even check if certain types of gears will work or not. But again, it's just for fun. It's not useful. So hope you might want to buy this program. If not, just play with the eval version and have fun. Hope you enjoyed this video.